For those of you who are perhaps not been with us the last few weeks, I just to tell you we've been working our way through Paul's first letter to Timothy, which has been a really interesting journey for us. We've been exploring different things about what Paul is saying to Timothy, but not just to Timothy. One of the things that I noted right at the beginning of this little series is that this was really an open letter. So it would have been read probably by the congregation as well. So you've got to kind of hear kind of some of the little meanings that I think Paul was getting at when he was writing this letter. So when he says to Timothy, "Timothy, stand up and make sure you correct the people that are wrong," you can imagine the people in the congregation sitting there going, "Oh, does that mean I'm going to feel Timothy coming to have a word with me?" It's that type of letter. It's not a closed letter. It's not a private letter. It was a very public letter. And last week we were looking at example, how Paul is encouraging Timothy and the church and therefore us to live our lives in such a way that our lives are an example of what it means to believe in Jesus, not just our words. And I want to kind of pick that up a little bit and move on. So we're in chapter 5 this week, but I only want to use the first couple of verses. So I'd encourage you, have a read of chapter 5. It's an interesting chapter. In some ways it's quite a challenging chapter, because some of the things that they're talking about are not quite so common in our church life today as they were in their church life. But I'd certainly encourage you to have a read. I want to look at particularly the first two verses, which read like this: "Don't rebuke an older man, but exhort him as a father, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, and the younger women as sisters with all purity." I want to look just at those two verses. And I've written down on my piece of paper here as kind of my title, so if you might want to think about this. I've written down as my title, "Family Dynamics." You know, families, they're great, aren't they, families? Who loves family? Yeah? Yeah, they're really good. I'm glad my dad said yes. That's good. You see, family dynamics, it's interesting, isn't it? I mean, who's ever had a family disagreement? Yeah? You ever had a fallout with your family? Someone's actually said no, but I won't tell you who it was. What I would say is this: when families fall out, it's always interesting, because some families have a real way of going at each other, and they can really go at each other. And they, do you know what? It's family. They always know exactly what to say to rile you. Yeah, do you know that? Yeah, have you experienced that? When perhaps one of your children or your parents even come along and they say that little comment and you kind of go, "Oh, why did you have to pick on that point?" Just me? Okay, just me, maybe. But Paul is opening up for us a picture of what church life should be like. And he's saying, because inevitably, we all disagree at some point, don't we? We all have little fallouts. I mean, I'm a master at saying the wrong thing. I've been known to say silly things at times, and I've had someone come and tap on my shoulder and say, "Jeff, you really need to go back, listen to what you just said." And I go, "Oh, yes, okay." And I kind of, yeah, maybe I need to rephrase that. But what happens when we fall out? How do we speak to each other? And these two little verses speak powerfully to how we as church family should interact and react, respond, help, encourage each other. And this first verse is a fascinating little verse. "Don't rebuke an older man." I mean, that's an interesting phrase in itself, especially seeing as through the whole letter of Timothy in your English Bible, Paul is saying to Timothy, rebuke the people who are teaching the wrong thing. Now, this is the problem with English. We have words that can mean different things at different times. And behind the English, the actual word that's being used here is a very unusual word for rebuke. It can be translated as this: to inflict blows or chide or reprove. So the idea is here, don't come up and aggressively speak at someone. Yeah? Don't do that. Don't speak at people. And the idea is, I mean, have you ever had a conversation with someone and you've gone away and felt like you've been emotionally beaten up? Or is that just me again? Maybe I have different friends to you. Sometimes you can feel like someone's words have literally assaulted you and you feel kind of bombarded and battered by them. And what Paul is saying to Timothy here is in all of these relationships, whether it be older people, younger people, whether it be men or whether it be women, whoever it is you're speaking to, don't throw your words at them. Don't come at them trying to knock them down. That's not what we're called to do and be. Instead, he says, exhort, persuade, call upon them. It's about coming alongside people rather than standing opposed to people. And I think the first thing that this verse speaks to me is that in church, as God's people, not just in church, but wherever we go as God's people, we shouldn't be those who verbally attack others. I've got a wonderful little book on my bookshelf at home. It's called Verbal Abuse. It's not a manual in how to verbally abuse people. Let me just make that clear. It's a little book about verbal abuse and how commonplace it has become to verbally assault people. We should not be like that. We're not called to attack people, but to help people. To encourage them. The exhortation is one of coming alongside, and how can I come alongside? And I might have a disagreement with you, but how can I come alongside and talk to you and persuade you? Now, I think, and I'm kind of just thinking generally here, I'm looking around all your lovely faces and I'm going, I don't think there are many of us that really go in for this verbal attack. Or at least you might, if you are one of those, you probably don't want to admit it. But I don't think there are many of us that do that. I think most of us understand we're meant to be nice to each other. Don't we? We got that bit. I think we've got that bit. But we are to exhort one another. And the idea here, again, is building each other up. In Ephesians 4, we're told that our words should build each other up, not tear each other apart. That's Ephesians. You can look at that. Ephesians 4:29. And I don't know about you, but I think that's the part of this that I find challenging. Because I don't know about you, I don't like really the thought of having to go up to someone and saying, I think you're wrong. Or, I don't like the way you've just behaved. It's made me feel very uncomfortable. I don't like to. I'd much rather go, never mind, see you next week. Yeah? It's a very English thing to do. I'm just looking around the room, thinking of those of you, my Bulgarian friends are hiding. Oh, there you are. It's very English, isn't it, Nadia? Yeah. Bulgaria, you have no problem going up to someone and saying, what have you just done? You don't mind at all, do you? No, it's cultural. We're English. You speak the truth. Yes, but do you do it lovingly? Do you do it lovingly? You see, you need to go back to point one. We must speak the truth lovingly towards you. But we must speak truth. And sometimes, I don't know about you, but sometimes it's a lot easier, especially if you're a nice, polite, sensible English person. It's often very easy to just bite your tongue, not say something, and just pretend it never happened. It doesn't help us grow in Christ. And I look at it like this. I mean, I have to put my hand on my heart and say, one of the most spiritually challenging, learning, growing times in my life has been toddler group. If you watch children and toddlers, they have no problem telling each other what they think. Have you noticed that? They'll walk up to you and say, I want that. And it's a standoff. Well, not all of them. But one of the things I've observed from watching children is they will tell you. I mean, my granddaughter will tell me when I do something that she thinks is silly, particularly when it's on a computer. She will get her little tablet out and she'll show me a game and she'll say, oh no, granddad, it goes like this. And then she'll show me. She has no problem telling me because she's a child and she hasn't been conditioned to behave the way adults are supposed to behave. Sometimes she does it a little bit too rudely and I have to tell her off. But I have to do it nicely, don't you? Especially when they're the grandkids. You have to do it nicely. But the point is this, we are supposed to speak into each other's lives. We're supposed to be encouraging each other to pursue Jesus. And we can't do that if we're not willing to speak up and exhort and say, do you know what? I think you're on a bit of a dangerous ground there. Or we might say to someone, you've just said something and it's really rattled me. Can I have a conversation with you about that? You do it nicely, you do it gently, but you have the conversation. I'll put my hand up and say, I'm still working on that one. I'm not number one, I'm definitely number two. I'm quite happy to just to stay quiet. Preach the truth, yes, but confronting people, ooh, that's a different thing. But in our little passage here, it says, right at the end, it says, with all purity. And I don't think that, I mean, a lot of commentators apply that just to the young girls. That Timothy, when you're approaching a younger woman, you should do it with all purity. Make sure that there's no misunderstanding. But I kind of think it applies to all of us. You see, as a church family, we should value purity and righteousness and holiness. We should value that. I don't know about you, but I mean, some of the people who've stood out in my life, people who I've met, who I've really admired, it's not often been their teaching that has struck me, but how they lived and how they treated other people, how they behaved, what it was like when you went to visit them in their home and you had a little conversation and there was no one else listening. You know, were they still honourable? Were they still respectful? Were they still loving and gracious and kind? And it's those things that have impacted me. And when it comes to tensions in family life, in church life, one of the things that's really important is when we do this, because I mean, if we're going to challenge, we don't want to be the person that's abusive and confrontational and aggressive and that everybody just walks over the road to avoid. We don't want to be that person, but we do want to speak to people. But when we do that talking, when we do that challenging, when we do that, have those conversations where we disagree, we need to value the purity and the righteousness and the holiness that we have in Christ Jesus. In Galatians chapter 6, it talks about, you know, be careful that you don't fall into sin. Be careful you don't fall into sin. In other words, if I think that, I'll pick on John because he likes me. If we've had some really interesting conversations actually, haven't we, in our fellowship group, in our small group. And I think it would be fair to say that John and I don't always come at things exactly the same way. Sometimes he's wrong. Now, that's a bit harsh, isn't it? So let me rewind that. Sometimes, actually, me and John come at things different ways. So I have to say to myself, how is John looking at this? And if I think about it and I say to John, tell me, John, what do you mean by that? Explain it a bit. Or I might ask a different question and he'll give me a reply. And we'll work out. And often I have felt, that's John's felt this because I've not asked him, but I've often felt we've ended up at the same place. But we've actually just started from a different place. And then I've learned something, because I've learned, oh, John looks at things slightly different to me. Maybe other people do too. And I can learn from that and grow. And he hopefully can learn and grow as I share how I see things. What we mustn't do is, when we disagree, fall back to that rebuking that is affronting and confrontational and abusive, because then we fall into sin. And what it's really difficult, I don't know about you, but have you ever found yourself dealing with someone who is being a bit aggressive? Do you find that you want to get aggressive too? You know, well, if you're going to be like that, I'll be like that. And you kind of, you can get drawn into the sin. We must value our purity and our holiness and the purity and the holiness of others. Respect them. Because all of this is this idea of talking to people, rebuking people, exhorting people, encouraging people. What's the point? The point is simple. It's for reconciliation. It's for redemption. That's the goal. That's where we're heading. One of my... One of the verses in the Bible that's become, I was going to say favourite, but I'm not sure it's a favourite in the sense of a positive one. It's been one of the verses that's stuck with me. Let me put it that way. It's stuck with me. And it's in Luke chapter 17, verse 3, where Jesus says, you know when Jesus was talking about forgive people 70 times 7 and all of that? This little phrase comes in that context, that conversation, where he says, if your brother sins, rebuke him, as in the second type, not the angry confrontation. They get alongside and talk about it. And if he repents, forgive him. And it's, well, how many times do you forgive? Well, a lot. The idea is it's a lifestyle of forgiveness. Why? Because the whole point of the gospel is that we would be forgiven of our sin. It's what we've been thinking about with communion. The price that Jesus paid on the cross is for the forgiveness of our sin. And we are supposed to be carrying that message with us, not just on our words, but on our deeds. It's a sign of love that we actually say, you know, we care about each other. And if someone goes astray, we'll get alongside them and we'll bring them back. And of course we'll forgive them. If they repent and they turn and they come back, we forgive them. Why? Because we want everyone to be included. Just kind of note the order. Sin, rebuke, repent, forgive. If someone sins, speak about it. Don't brush it under the carpet. If they acknowledge it and repent and turn from it, they're forgiven. I find that process quite an interesting one, quite a challenging one. If I'm the person who has not sinned, so if it's you that's been bad, I have problem with step two. I find it difficult to go up to you and say, I don't like that. I think you've gone wrong. I find that hard sometimes. But if it's the other way around and you come up to me and say, Jeff, I think you've gone wrong, I often have a little bit of a, I kind of want to go, what do you mean? I find it very easy to get defensive. Do you find that? I do. I find it very easy. And the repenting part, it's quite challenging. It's quite humbling to say, yeah, okay, I was wrong. Yeah, I didn't do that right, did I? Oh dear. It's so much easier if you know you'll be forgiven. So much easier if you know you're going to be forgiven. That's what it makes. That's why it's so much easier to deal with God than each other. Because I know that when I go to God, he's going to forgive me. And I look at you lot and I go, please God, let them forgive me. I'm not quite so confident. But that's what we're called to be as God's family. That we care for each other. We love each other. We support each other. If someone goes wrong, we pick them up and put them back on the right track. It's just like toddler group. My job at toddler group is to guard the door. Yeah. And you know how many times a week some of those little characters will head for the door without a parent? Amazing. My job is to stand there and go, no. Turn around and go back. And normally they faces drop. Sometimes they kind of go, ah. But normally they turn around and they go back and I go, yay, well done. We celebrate when people turn and come back. And we rejoice over every sinner that's saved. But we must guard the door. People say to me sometimes, why do you think it's so important to challenge people about sin and about wrongdoing? Why do you think it's so important to teach the truth? The illustration that's in my head every single time is really, really simple. I don't let little kids do stupid things that might hurt them. If I really care about you, why would I let you do a stupid thing that's going to hurt you? Wouldn't I try and stop you? And hopefully you won't do it. You'll turn and come back. And then we're right then, aren't we? This is what our family, our church family, is meant to be like. That we care for each other. That we love each other. We don't throw words at each other just for the sake of it. We'll come alongside each other and exhort and encourage. We do because we want to guard the good living, the good example, the purity and the holiness that is gifted to us in Christ Jesus. So I encourage you this week, if you want to say something that's a bit rude, bite your tongue. But if you see someone that needs a word of encouragement, speak up. But remember, we do it with love. We do it care so we don't put a foot wrong ourselves. And our objective is always that we're guarding the purity and the holiness that we've been gifted in Christ Jesus our Lord, both in ourselves and in the other person. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the tremendous grace and love that you have poured out upon us. Thank you for calling us to be your people in this place, your family. May we grow up to be like you. May we put away harsh, confrontational words. May we learn how to encourage and support. May we always do it carefully, guarding the life and the righteousness that you've gifted us in Christ Jesus, we pray.